A very good evening to everyone present here. It's a moment and an evening of very much gladness to us, because this lecture that we have organized today is a part of our BASE Academic Lecture Series 2021. I would like to let everyone know that during the past 1 year, BASE, Bengali Academia for Social Empowerment, has organized several academic lectures. And this is a continuation and a much more categorized representation of that approach. So I welcome you all to this platform. And without much delay, I would request our esteemed Professor Abdul Mateen to please introduce BASE, to please say a few words about BASE so that our esteemed speaker and our audience today can know about BASE, and then introduce our speaker. Over to you, Abdul Mateen sir. Thank you.
Thanks, Zahira. Zahira is assistant professor. She teaches English at the Surendranath College here at Calcutta, which is affiliated to University of Calcutta. She is also part of BASE working body. I think by now many of us we know about BASE, the Bengali Academia for Social Empowerment, and we all know when we defined the idea of Bengali, the idea of academia, the idea of social, the idea of empowerment, and it's a very heavy loaded terms. And BASE being of course is a development organization, it engages with a lot of stuffs, you know, including relief works, educational interventions, it organized a lot of career counseling programs, including giving helps to a lot of underprivileged students coming from different marginalized communities. But beyond development organizations, it's also about it's also an organization which engages with a lot of ideas, you know, and 21st century is an age of idea, and where different multiple ideas, right, from Babasaheb Ambedkar's to Periyar to Phule, and including our very local icons here in Bengal, whether from Kaji Nazrul Islam or to and many such scholars in Bengals, and BASE engages seriously and wants to create an alternative culture in the sense which is based on sense of dignity, sense of egalitarian values, and also BASE wants to create an alternative narratives as far as development is concerned, as far as engaging with marginalized communities are concerned. Well, I don't want to take much time, and this BASE is a kind of movement, and it's a platform, it's a forum where apart from our academic activities, we engage seriously on different public issues of affirmative actions, issues of positive discriminations, and BASE actively engages with day-to-day issues in public life here in West Bengal, including many parts of other parts of India. Well, being this word, and I would like to, today we are very much privileged to have Dr. Manju Dachira, and we call her Manju. Manju completed her, of course, she's a very seasoned, a brilliant student, right? From her, like, I was going through her CV, right from class 10 onwards, it's all first class with distinctions. Because Manju completed her undergraduate from University of Calicut, and then later University of Hyderabad, and then did MPhil, MA, and as well as PhD. She was also a fellow, Erasmus Plus fellow at Germany. Erasmus Fellow in Freie University Berlin. Apart from her academic contributions, she regularly writes in different forum, in both in Malayalam as also in English, and her PhD thesis is a very I would like to sort of name the title of her thesis, Effective Archives, Caste and Contemporary Malayalam Cinema. And of course, her recent article at EPW, listen, the last year, the Anti-Caste Aesthetics and Dalit Intervention in Indian Cinema, really gives a different perspective, not to just exaggerate, but it gives a different understanding of how we look at society, how we making and unmaking of identities in through cinema, and how cinema also is an hegemonic platform, and how it creates and how it produce and reproduce different concepts and different identities. Well, we are very much privileged, and that Manju has kindly agreed to spare some times with us, and she widely travels in different parts of Europe, including, and she has presented in different universities within India as well as beyond, like University of Hyderabad, including University of Chicago, Max Planck Institute at Berlin, Humboldt University Berlin, then and of course Bombay, Cochin, and list is on and on. I don't want to take your time, but we would like to. This is a basically half an hour, 45 minutes lecture, then followed by question answer. We would like our esteemed audience to be a bit interactive. Maybe she'll speak for 35 to 40 minutes, and then we'll have a round of question answer. With these words, and I would like to thank the base for organizing this, to giving me opportunity to introduce speaker. And with these few words, this is over to Dr. Manju.
Okay. First of all, thanks a lot for that long and warm introduction, Abdul. And yeah, I would like to thank Abdul for inviting me to talk today. So Abdul is a very good friend, and also to Bengali Academia for Social Empowerment for this opportunity to share my work. I'm really looking forward to this opportunity. So I'll let me try to present the PPT which I have. Okay, so I'll directly go to the talk. Just titled Towards an Anti-Caste Aesthetics, Deconstructing Gaze in Indian Cinema. So though I call it as Indian cinema, I would be talking as Indian in the sense that I would be talking about different industries within India. So it would be, I would be talking about Malayalam film industry, Tamil, Marathi, and also a little bit of Hindi, but not much of Bengali today. But then, yeah, I would be talking about this four industries in particular. So that's why it is deconstructing gaze in Indian cinema. So I thought I would start with what is gaze in film studies, because cinema is perceived as largely a visual medium of entertainment, though sound is also an equally important part. It is largely perceived as largely perceived as a visual medium. So it is, there are so many theories on how we see or how we look at cinema or the frame or the image. So one of the very important studies which actually theorized this particular look in film studies is Laura Mulvey's Visual Pleasure and Narrative Cinema, which was published in 1975, which kind of changed the way we look at cinema or we perceive cinema. So gaze, in a sense that if we can loosely call it like something where we like kind of an intense look or more in a sense that there are like two dimensions of it. One is to look at, and the other one is to be looked at. So the ones to look at has more power in comparison to be looked at. So it is also that kind of that paradigm, it is at work in this study. So through that, so what Mulvey does in her work is she actually looks at gays all in relation to the in relation to women, or in a sense that she studies the Hollywood classical cinema, or what is called as what we call as narrative cinema of the 1960s 70s. So where she takes up psychoanalysis as a framework to analyze this particular the cinema of that period. So what she does is she actually talks about the particular look of the or the look or the gaze which the film produces, or it's something which is already constructed within that within the frame or within the cinema. So she talks about three looks. So one is the look of the camera, which is the camera whoever is operating that, in a sense that it is during that time it's largely a male gaze which was at work. So there'll be a man behind the camera, and there'll be characters within the screen. So there'll be characters of films. So they'll have a gaze which towards each other, or to the, or perhaps to the camera itself. So there'll be a gaze within within the frame, which is a second look, which is also a male gaze, and the third one is the look of the spectator. So these three looks together constitutes what she calls as male gaze, which is in a sense that even if you watch even if you are a woman and you watch the film, you would be looking through a particular kind of you would be looking through a certain kind of male sensitivity or male sensibility to the screen, not necessarily in any other ways, because there would be a particular kind of look which is generated. So that she says how it is done. So there would be so she takes it up. She takes up from psychoanalysis. So she takes Freud's theory of scopophilia and Lacan's theory on narcissism. So scopophilia is largely an objectified look or a voyeuristic look. So when there is a woman who is represented on the screen, so the look or the gaze of the spectator becomes largely an objectified look, like any the way which is constructed, and also the way we see both kind of together produces what is what she calls as an objectified look or a voyeuristic look. And at the same time, there is also another way where we look at narcissism. Narcissism, in a sense that she looks at Lacan's mirror. She takes up from Lacan's mirror image, where there will be whenever we see ourselves on the mirror, or we actually see a better self on the mirror. It is in a sense that it is. He takes the 6 months old baby who looks at the mirror, and what he or she sees is a better image. So it is from that sense a male gaze is formulated, whereas a woman is an objectified is an object to look at, or object to be looked at. So it is within these frameworks she argues that the Hollywood classical cinema, the gaze which that produces, where male gaze is always active and female becomes a passive observer. So in a sense that woman becomes an image and man as just bearer of the look. So this is something which is a larger framework she creates to study the white American films of 1970s or 60s, 70s. So where the gaze which cinema or the film produces is male gaze. It's a patriarchal. She talks about how such a gaze is being produced through these through the films of that era. So it kind of set up a different dimension to film studies especially in terms of looking from a different in a sense that an oppressed position, because here in a sense that women are being always objectified. So taking from here, what we would look at is what happens when, so Malvi looks at what happens with the women, and what will happen when you look at race also into this paradigm. So so looking at Malvi's theory, which came in 1975, later bell hooks, who's a prominent African American scholar, she's also like very prominent African American feminist as well. So she has a piece called The Oppositional Gaze, The Black Female Spectators. So where she looks at this Malvi's formulation of man as woman as an image, and man where she looks at this Malvi's conceptualization of this active male gaze and passive female gaze. So in order to look at this particular power structure within which such a gaze is formulated, she takes up from the slaves, the black slaves who were brought from Africa to America, and they never had the right to look at their masters. So that she kind of recounts her own experiences of as a child, how she was not allowed to look back at adults at certain point of time. So to connecting these two things, she talks about how the right to look was prohibited, especially for the slaves African American slaves. So this constant suppression of the right to gaze or the right to look at kind of produced an overwhelming desire to look back, in a sense that you look back in order to resist, right? So so if you are told not to look at, there will be always a desire to look back in a sense that to break the whatever is prohibited on you, you have this tendency to break that. So this particular repression made them to look back at their masters, even though they were punished for the act they did, as in a sense that for looking back at their masters. So they were always they were supposed to have a head down position, not necessarily always to look at their masters. So from this particular thing, as in looking back as resistance, is what Malvi takes up in order to formulate what she calls as oppositional gaze. So she looks at Malvi calls as phallocentric gaze of Hollywood cinema. So that it is important when you look at the white American films, whereas when black female spectators, when they watch this images or this films on screen, there is something else which was happening at that time. It was not necessarily, they never felt like they were being oppressed or they were being victimized. Instead, what they felt was they couldn't identify neither with the victim, which is the white woman, nor with the perpetrator, which can be even a white man or black man, anybody, because largely at that time also there were very negative portrayal of even black men even from early 90s. So neither with the, they could not identify neither with the victim nor with the perpetrator. Is my screen visible?
Yeah, it's visible.
This is visible.
Just went off. Okay. Let me just try again to make it enlarge it. Okay. This black female spectators, they could not identify neither with the victim nor with the perpetrator. So they kind of rejected what was shown to them or what was there on the screen, which is a kind of a rejection of whatever mainstream images. And they looked at these images through what Hooks calls as an oppositional gaze, where you would actually look back and then you don't identify this. And this oppositional gaze kind of, in a sense, deconstructed was what Malvi was proposing, or the active male gaze and the passive female gaze. So it is something which was, because you don't identify with what is seen on what is shown on the screen. So in a sense this is what later also made them to produce their own alternative productions or black films, which are largely rooted in black aesthetics. So they rejected these images which were on the screen, this largely mainstream white images, and started producing their own different alternative productions. But in that, there are directors like Spike Lee, who emerged as famous black directors, but somebody like Hooks also criticizes the representation of women, and especially black women, and even in Spike Lee's production. So there were a kind of very conscious black female spectatorship which was there at that point of time. So which she actually interviews people and then takes their responses, and that's how she came to this conclusion, or she came to this idea of oppositional gaze. And to take that, and so this idea of oppositional gaze is very important to what I would be talking about, what I would be talking today, because so in the context of India, so we have another oppressive system called caste. So it also produces certain kind of a gaze. So race also produces one kind of gaze, because it is just the moment, like if you know that when they see us, so the moment you see a black, you, the attitude changes, or the society treats them in an altogether different way. So how does caste gaze works in relation to what we have just seen as a gaze based on race? So here it works at a different, like, as we know, it works at more of a notional level. So what I would be looking at here is the how caste works as a sensorial regime, how there are certain kind of impositions on our senses, especially how people, especially Dalits, were treated as untouchables, unseeables, unhearable. So your like touch, your sight, your hearing, all these had certain kind of prohibitions. So you were not to be seen, not to be heard, or not to be touched. So there is the kind of how the sensorial, how caste works as a sensorial regime is something which I want to foreground, because it is very important in terms of cinema, where it's not necessarily just the look or the gaze, but it is something more than that. We also hear and we feel touched by certain films. So what these things we would be looking at it when we look particularly, like, certain, I mean, I would be looking at certain films here. So there we would see that. So so from this oppositional gaze, what I am trying to look at in this context is, there is a book called To Be Cared For, The Power of Conversion and Foreignness of Belonging in an Indian Slum, which was written by Nathaniel Roberts. It's a 2016 book. So in this book, he talks about, is a book about Dalit Christians in a slum in Chennai. In this book, there is an instance where this people of the slum, they tell Roberts that the rich or the rich people, or they call actually as rich people, or the upper class or upper caste people, look at them as they see you, but they don't even look at you, or they don't they pretend that they don't see you. They kind of neglect you or ignore you. Because he takes up the word called par, which means to look at in Tamil. The word has a meaning called par, which is to look at, but it also has another meaning, which is to attend to someone out of like concern, to take care of. So you tell that, okay, please take care of him or her, which also has that particular meaning, like you just see him, or that is the meaning which is invoked here. So taking that, this the people of the community says that this upper caste people don't see us, they always ignore us, they always, it's a certain kind of an invisibilization which is at work. So I take this to see how cinema in India has treated Dalits in particular, because there would be either the Dalits would be the either invisibilized, because some of them they might be there, we don't know, because there would have been people who would be working with certain production jobs, or not necessarily production, but like some menial jobs there, or as background performers. We never know, we don't know the statistics, nothing. But yeah, if they are on the screen, they are like either stereotyped, or their presence would be erased. So it is taking from there, what I would try to argue is that this particular invisibility or erasure or stereotyping, which you can see in if you take films of in like many regions, how there is a representation of Dalits in this region. So I've taken like three examples here. One is Malapilla, which is a 1938 Telugu film. Then there is one, the Neelakuyil, which is 1954 Malayalam film, and Sujata, which is 1959 Hindi film. So all these have Dalit women characters. So but there is a different kind of narrative, which either it's a patronizing gaze, or it's a progressive, like how do you like make them progressive, or in Neelakuyil she actually she's killed in the narrative. So it is, there is a way this all these films do all these three things, which are like invisibilize, erase, or stereotype. So from there, that's what is invisibilization. I take from this to be cared for. And so what happens from there is a shift, which we would see later on in Indian cinema, which is especially recent emergence of Dalit filmmakers. Like for instance, I've just taken three names, which are Nagaraj Manjule in Marathi, Paranjit and Mari Selvaraj in Tamil. And there are also people who are making this kind of films in other film industries also. I mean, for instance, Telugu has very interesting films these days. So so there is a different, there's a shift from this particular caste case, which was there for a long time, which it is still there. But then these filmmakers who actually very consciously make films, there is, of course, they have a certain kind of an oppositional gaze towards the mainstream cinema. So they like continuously deconstruct the images which are there in the mainstream cinema, but they also produce something else, which is a look which cares, an affective look, which in a sense that it not necessarily reaches out to, or like when you see the film, it actually, what I was also suggesting in the beginning, we were talking about caste as a sensorial regime, how how does these films actually break these things through certain kind of like reaching out to people, in a sense that through music or through as in sound or a certain kind of a haptic visuality, which haptic visuality is in a sense that a visuality that touches, like when you see the film you feel you're affected or you're touched by it. So it is, these are the things, these are the ways that through which these people are, or these directors are operating these days. So what they do is they in a sense that they deconstruct what is being given to us as popular, but they not necessarily they do it as an alternative platform. They in fact they do this within the popular within the popular cinema itself. So they actually enter the popular cinema or the popular film industry, and then they deconstruct certain images which have been circulated or the frozen images of certain industries, and then they produce certain effective images. There is something very interesting which these directors do, there is a going beyond the real, which what I call, because there is the Indian cinema which actually looks at this realism as a mode to work with, because especially the new cinema movement, which actually though they were largely seen as art cinema or parallel cinema, so that was actually also funded by the state and produced certain different, as in like a move towards realism, which is also taken from this Hollywood classic cinema or French New Wave and all these things. But then there is always a tendency to make films like to look like real or to be more closer to the real. So but then what we see in these directors, it's not necessarily like a sort of like a documentary making, or you are just making just a real image, but there is something else which they are doing, which they actually take these instances or what we call as real and break the quote unquote real. So which I would tell in the next slide how it is done with a particular example. So it is what I am trying to look at in this is there is a certain kind of like we largely talk about representation. So the questions on representation, it kind of restricts us to the questions of like, for instance, stereotyping or invisibilization or erasure, but not more than that. What happens at the production level, or who makes these films? So all these things also come to focus when we look at the question of presence. So who are there, like who is making these films? So the presence of these anti-caste filmmakers actually changes the way cinema in India is also conceived or produced, because after these directors, or at least for instance in Tamil, you can see a lot of traces of for instance Ranjit's style of filmmaking in many other filmmakers. So there is certain kind of an influence which these people have, or the way they or their films create an impact, which I mean at least in the film field. So Ranjit is also different in that sense, because he has a production house, he produces especially films done by like films of films done by largely people from oppressed groups, and he has music band which is he supports music. It's called Castless Collective, So it he also has a publication house. So there are so many at so many level these people. The presence is not necessarily a presence of like just being anti-caste or a Dalit person. It's also a presence in multiple levels. You are doing certain many things, or you are doing many things at many levels in, and that in fact reflects also through your films. So that is very interesting if you look at, especially in the case of Ranjit. So so I actually take the idea of this presence or presentation because there is this French philosopher Jean-Luc Nancy, his work The Birth to Presence, where he talks about how presence is how representation is something which is limiting, whereas presence is to be born or to but not necessarily as a static, like you born into only this category. No, not as, not like that, but as something where you transcend everything, like to your birth, to actually like it's just the kind of a presence where art is in that sense a kind of presence where you break all these barriers. So it is at that sense I take, in that sense I take the phrase also presence, also in terms of like in its bare meaning, which is the presence of people within the industry, and also art as something to present. So this is what I take from here, and what these people do through their aesthetics is a sort of there's an aesthetics of becoming, because Indian cinema has already produced, or Indian cinema in a larger sense, I look at, like I am talking largely from this dominant images, where it has actually created certain kind of images which are frozen in, like which are also like we have already consumed it, and how do you break that? So in order to break that, these people work with aesthetics, that and aesthetics of becoming. It is also important in the case of Dalits, because there is, the being itself is violated on an everyday basis, like people are being killed. So how, what, so it's like how this, the importance of becoming or the being itself is becoming, it's that in that sense is aesthetics of becoming. It's also about the possibilities which these films offer, or these aesthetics offer. So so I'll go to the next slide. So from there, I would be talking about a little bit on anti-caste aesthetics. So the anti-caste aesthetics is also the aesthetics of becoming. So so the larger conceptualization of aesthetics is largely dominant. So if you look at the conceptualizations of aesthetics from the West, it's largely dominant. But then that does not mean that we reject that particular category itself. So aesthetics is something like if you go according to the etymology, it has so many meanings. So it is study of arts maybe, or it is a branch of philosophy. It is also like how do we perceive things, also a science of maybe like something to do with beauty. All these things are some of the definitions or some of the ways we can look at aesthetics. So but then what these people do, or these directors do, is they actually look at the aesthetics of experience and aspirations. So these films will have all these elements, this aesthetics of experience and aspiration. So it is an everyday life, and then how you incorporate the things like music, cinematography, and other elements into this aesthetic. So there is a shift which I take in my work, which is There is a work, Sharan Kumar Limbale's work on Dalit aesthetics, which actually rejects the category of aesthetics, which is, and it actually foregrounds something called Dalit aesthetics. From there, I would make a move towards anti-caste aesthetics, because these films, especially Ranjit, so they actually don't want to make a cinema called Dalit cinema. They want to make cinema which would reach out to everyone. So it's, they do not want to categorize their cinema, or they do not want to, though they are very active, or though they are very very socially committed, they would actually look at these as anti-caste efforts, because so what Ranjit has already he already has a band which is Casteless Collective, so which there is a move from this essentializations to something else, which is they are going towards this anti-caste aesthetics. So I have actually looked at some of this, like Sandri and Sairat by Manjule, Madras Kabali and Kala, these are three Tamil films by Ranjit, and Pariyarum Perumal and Karnan by Mari Selvaraj. Though I won't be talking largely about all this, like in detail about all these films, like maybe I would spend a little more time on Karnan, which just released recently. So it is, I would talk largely on that. So what, as a conceptual framework, I actually look at how this idea of affect and aesthetics are working together in their case. So in this, you would see like how these people use music or cinematography and history, because some of them actually produce like it, for instance, like you actually take certain things which happened in the past, but then not necessarily as a documentary, but as cinema, as the cinematic, using all the technology or all the things which cinema offers. So these, what I argue as these films work as what I call as affective archives. So I would just quickly talk about what is affective archive, or what do I call as affective archive. I would just talk about that here, and then come back to that slide. So there is, we know both the terms, there is affect and there is archive. So what is archive is largely what, like historical documents. So affect is something in a sense that in both sense, one is affect to affect other and to be affected by others. So that is one sense of the term affect I'm using here. And also, as you actually see archives or historical documents as something which is only rational and historic and largely at a not necessarily as an affective document or a document that can have affect. So it is, so where I look at these archives, so the personal and the intimate, how this archive can also be seen as something where you store the personal and the intimate. So there is an incorporation of feelings and sensibilities into the realm of historical knowledge, and the affect it generates. So there is a shift from looking at archive not necessarily as an object but also as an experience. You actually experience the archive. So that is something which we can see in all these films. So how they also work as affective archive, maybe affective archives of maybe certain time period, or affective archives of certain the horrors of brutality or the everyday caste violence. So which is also affect, like it's so traumatic, but it also carries that. So then so I actually look at two things, how in terms of this archive. One is how this archive works as archive of feeling. So how we can actually preserve effect in archives. The second thing which is taken from Chekhovic is an affect theorist, so it's taken from her work. So it is she talks about how affect can be preserved in archives. She actually looks at the queer activists and their experiences. So it is these studies are also from the oppressed groups. So that is very interesting. Who takes this questions in academia? And the second one is archive affect, which is viewers' affective experience of archives, which is taken from Jamie Barron's work. So how viewers or how the spectators actually experience the archives, so their affective experience or their or what they feel or what they feel when they experience the archives. So I actually take these two things to look at the emancipatory potential of archival documents beyond post-structural skepticism. So there is the term affect or something which is actually looked down upon, not necessarily as rational epistemological works, but so I look at this thing, the emancipatory potential of archival documents, not necessarily as just as knowledge, but as something which is empowering, as something which is emancipatory. So I actually take an example of a film called Celluloid in 2013 to study this. So Celluloid is the film on, it's a Malayalam film, which is on the making of the first Malayalam film called Vigathakumaran, which was made in 1928. So this film actually is an attempt to kind of historicize what happened in 1928. So this is a 2013 film. So what the film did is very interesting thing, because the film actually went back and actually recreated what happened it's a film, like it's not necessarily as like what we call as maybe historical document in one sense, but then the film had it picturized the director. It's actually a biopic of the director of the film called J.C. Daniel, but it also had other people who appeared on the screen, like who were also the participants of the film, like then. So there is something which I found quite interesting, is the story of P.K. Rossi. So P.K. Rossi is the first female actress of even South Indian cinema, I think. She is also the, not South Indian cinema, sorry, the, in Malayalam cinema. So she's also the first Dalit woman heroine of Malayalam cinema. So her history was not known. Even the history of Celluloid the Vigathakumaran was not known for a long time, because the prints of this film is not available. There is no print at all. The film is lost forever. So in a sense, that Celluloid works as an archive of that film, which was made in 1928, which is not there. So I would just talk a little bit on Rossi. So Rossi was the first. She's the first female actress, and also a Dalit woman. But then when she acted in the film and the film was released, the upper caste members of Kerala society made a lot of ruckus over her presence in the film, and they actually unleashed violence on her, on the film, on her family. So she had to finally leave. Kerala to Tamil Nadu. So that's her history. We don't know anything about her. So her history was in fact not known, though there is a Dalit historian called Kundukuri Mani, who's been doing a lot of work on her from 1970s, but it was never popular. Like, it was only in certain circles which was circulated she is the first heroine of Malayalam cinema and all the details. But what Celluloid does is there is a different, like, though the film is though the film tries to erase her presence or bring her back to again kill her, or in a sense that there is, she does not have much screen space in the film. She comes and she actually goes off so soon. So there were a lot of critiques from especially Dalit Bahujan intellectuals that the film is actually like, it just kind of recreates the past thing. So they just bring her back in order to kill her again. So but that particular incident of celluloid created a lot of discourse on Rosie. So from different parts of Kerala, like people have written in even social media, in many journals, and in also there were many lectures. So many things emerged at that point of time, which is around 2013. So it took such a long time to unearth or to make her history popular. So what I would, such a historical thrust, which I call it as an effective archiving of somebody's life. So this is what I take as, for example, as an effective archive. So we can also see this kind of documentation also in all this director's work. So before going there, I would just talk a little bit on I was talking about, there's something called going beyond the real. So I have an image here which is a scene, last scene from Fandry, a film by Vanjule, where the protagonist, Dalit boy, throws a stone at the
Manju.
Unmute, Manju.
Manju, please unmute yourself. We cannot hear you.
Yeah. I just did that. I didn't know. It just went. Okay. Okay, I'll just talk like this because it is. I'm trying to do the slideshow, but it's not working. So there's a scene from Fandry where the protagonist, who's a Dalit boy, who throws a stone at the camera. In a sense, that also to the spectator. So. In a sense, there is a after this. Okay. Is it visible?
Yeah.
So there is a breaking away from the narrative space which is happening here, because the stone comes to the camera, then there is a that it blackens out, and then it goes off. So there is the this is where I was in a sense that suggesting that there's a move towards like to break. There is always like the real picture or the realisms of Indian cinema has always projected Dalits and Bahujans as somebody who was always, there is a stereotyping of this, of the community. So the thing which is being questioned through this, through such an act. So yeah, I will try to connect it when I come to the discussion of Karnan. How much time do I have?
Yeah, yeah, take no issues. Roshedda is okay. Looking at the time.
Yeah, I have just more slides. So yeah. So to start off, like where I had left, which is anti-caste aesthetics as effective archives of all these films which I was talking about. So I would just talk about the I would just talk about a little bit on the anti-caste aesthetics and I actually study these anti-caste aesthetics or the efforts of these directors as something in a sense that these, how these work as in aesthetics, which is a philosophical term by Alain Badiou, who is a French philosopher, who actually tells that his concept of in aesthetics, art is itself a producer of truths, and philosophy need not interfere in the production of artistic truths. So in a sense that cinema is producing its own philosophy, that is, in simple terms, it is that. So these cinemas or these films, in a sense that it produces the kind of truths or what the kind of aesthetics or the what we can call as the kind of art these films produce is actually that cannot be found anywhere else. This can only be done perhaps through this. That's what he actually calls as in aesthetics, that is something, the possibility of art, where you, the otherwise impossibilities, or the otherwise impossibilities in the sense is it was otherwise impossible in other mainstream cinema or with the dominant filmmaking, whereas in this one it is quite they actually open up the sensibility or what we can call as the aesthetics. So which actually I take from this two particular theories. One is Badiou's in aesthetics, then other one is Antonin Artaud, as a French theater practitioner, the theater and its double, where he was largely an avant-garde practitioner, where he wanted to make a lot of changes in the theater practice, where not necessarily too much of dialogue, but more of expression or gesture, what he calls. And like through this, like the sudden changes on the screen, all through this, he wanted to unsettle the emotions of the spectator. So you don't get what you actually look for or the predictable. You always get the unpredictable. So this is something which he wanted to do in his work. This is also something which we can see in the works of these anti-caste filmmakers. For instance, we don't expect like a film like Sairat, where it, like, you just see the end in the end, you just see both the protagonists dead. Or for instance, if you take the film called Pariyerum Perumal, where you don't, it's not a heroic end, or it's not a tragic end, where the hero actually is open for a dialogue with the upper caste people or his lover's father, who's an upper caste man. So there is something, these are the things at which like these directors work, But this is not though it might be similar to perhaps Attar or Badiou, it's not the same, where there is a difference here with this directors, which are, they are at once they are poetic and political, and there is a move towards like negative to the positive, a kind of particular to the universal, though you would be talking something which is set in a very particular place, but there's a universal thing in a sense that also you need also universal appeal or even though you also reach out to the wider public, and also the being to becoming or the aesthetics of becoming. So these are the things which these directors actually do. So to talk in detail, I thought I would just talk a little bit on Karnan, which is a Tamil movie by Mari Selvaraj. It's a 2021 film, though it was released in theaters quickly. It went to like because of pandemic lockdown and all, very few days it ran in theaters, but then it was also later it was released in Amazon Prime, and it is very in a sense that is very interesting film in many ways. One is it is loosely based on 1995 Kodaikanal caste violence, which is actually a particular an incident which happened in 1995, where there was a police raid in a village called Kodaikanal, and people were killed, people were tortured in a Dalit village, in fact largely a village of a community of Pallas, one of the Dalit communities in Tamil Nadu. So it is that particular incident which actually led to this film. But you don't see, like, it's not exactly what happened there. You only see certain this actually only a though there it is an it is based on a historical incident, it is something different. Like the film is totally different. The film has a lot of other elements at work. One is the significance of naming from the name itself, like from the title of the film itself, which is Karnan. The film has a lot of there's a significance of naming. So Karnan is a character in Mahabharata, and so there are but then the film very clearly tells that it is not a story of the Karnan of Mahabharata, because it's not the Karnan who is the son of Surya, or the sun, S-U-N, sun. So there is a distinction, there is a distinct or not of the Karna of the Mahabharata. So it is different. So what happens? So the significance of naming, in the sense that Dalits were not allowed to name, especially these kind of names, in a sense these were mostly considered as upper caste names. So in the film itself, there are instances where these people are beaten up because they kept names like Duryodhana, Karnan, or they all have different kinds of like those names from this myths, which is Yemen, all these names you can see in the film. So and also how they were treated or how they were beaten up by the police when they know that these people are from this particular community, and how they how can they have such names. So it is, naming is also very important in anti-caste politics. So these certain things, these kind of even small things, even just take for instance, even Ranjit's films like Kala and Kabali, these are not very accepted names. So these are also, like, Kabali is a lower caste or a Dalit name. Kala means like black or dark. So how he takes these names and brings into the mainstream is also very important. So this is something which Mari Selvar Raj does. Here it's a complete inversion. So you take Karnan. So when you hear Karnan, what comes to your mind, perhaps it is largely the Karna of Mahabharata. So how you actually change that and deconstruct what particular notions we had on Karnan, and you offer something else, which is in a sense in this film, he actually create a certain kind of a metaphoric effect. So you see a lot of symbols or metaphors in the film. It's the film is very rich in that sense, because you see a lot of small things which has multiple meanings or larger meanings than what we see on screen. So here we don't, it's not necessarily we just identify with what is there on the screen, but it works at a larger sense. It actually pushes you to think in multi dimensions. So one is there is a restraint, there's a donkey whose legs are tied up throughout the film, and it actually shows something else. So the donkey cannot move, so it is at the end, like this Karnan cuts it off and the donkey actually goes off. So it shows certain kind of like how the society restricts or certain impositions can make people weak, or it's not shown as like the whole film has a lot of like other interesting things. There is a folk deity with a kind of different kind of head. So there is a black horse, or what we can in fact also call as the, we can also see it as like how he emerges as somebody who's victorious, but not necessarily in a popular cinema terms, because his life was actually the state and the police, they all finish his life off, but then he actually comes back to a different in a different society. So it is in that sense, it is these symbols are also important. And there is a headless figure in the headless painting in the film, which is that is the people draw this, but then they were not able to complete the head. But then later on it is with the military uniform that head is being like green color shirt, maybe the head is being the picture is being portrayed. But then later they actually paint it with a character who dies in the end. But this also has reference to the politics of even Tamil Nadu, where there was a leader called Emmanuel Shekharan, who was who actually died was killed by the upper caste, dominant caste people. So the film does this kind of minute things, though it is not at all said in the film. It can be a reference to this particular person. So these nuanced readings of this through paintings or the symbols, all these things we can see. And also there is a butterfly in the police station where these people Dalit leaders or the village leaders are being beaten up. So this was when you look at the film trivia, it just shows up that it was something which was not planned. So butterfly just came and then the cameraman or the cinematographer could capture it. So it is also a momentary thing to be looked at. And so the film talks about this also, how these people, how the people of the community would want to, their aspirations, they want education, which is denied because they do not have a bus stop in their village. So they are they do not have a bus stop, and they have to go to another village, which is an upper caste village, to take a bus. But then every time when they go there, there'll be something or the other violence on them. So which is like in a sense that they do not even get a bus stop. So the film in fact tells that people know that if we go study or travel, we might reach other places, or we might also improve our status. So they don't want that. So there is always an aspiration to get a government job or education, or even Karnan tries to enroll into military, tries to enter into military, but then he later on he doesn't go there. Though he is selected, he doesn't go there. So the generation of an earlier era, they wanted the younger generation to go out or to escape from what they had experienced. So all these things, though it might look as something which is it is just like similar to what aspiration or education or military, but it also shows like two kinds of two sides. One is the state oppression, and the other side how these people's aspirations or their will to life are questioned. So this is something which we can see in the film, and I think I have taken a lot of time. I would just close off with, yeah, the film has a lot of it does not show the usual like the pain or the humiliation. So it actually ends up with a positive positive note, a community of celebrations of dance. So which is, these are something which we can actually look at, not necessarily. And also a film has multiple you can see a lot of animals and creatures in this film. So this is an interbeing of people like that is also being portrayed in the film. So in a sense that these films open up we can actually look at these films through the lens of ACDC's affect and archive, and also these films actually offer us something else, like through different perhaps through metaphors, perhaps through the story, perhaps through the characters. So these are some of the ways at which this anti-caste ACDC is at work, and it is also deconstructing what has been shown till then, but also offers something more, which is at the level of sensorium, like the music, the kind of feelings which are invoked. So which is something which we can actually look for. So it's one image which I had taken. So it is also like with this shadow shot so like these kind of images are so much, like if you have seen this Mahabharata kind of posters, which also has these kind of images where the victorious person would stand on dead bodies, and it is shown like that. But here in a sense, here it is all inverse. He had to actually fight to save the life of his people or his community. So it is also shadow. It's also covering the sun behind. So in a sense that it is an inversion of the previous images. So I would stop here with this, and I would just stop the presentation.
Murshida is there now. Dr. Murshid Alam will coordinate the question and answer session. Thanks, Manju, for your quite important and deep talk on culture and cinema. And this is over to Dr. Murshid Alam, who is assistant professor at the Department of English at Gaur College, which is affiliated to Gaur Bengal University in Malda, and also equally brilliant scholar on cultural studies and many other subjects. Thanks. This is over to Murshida.
Okay. Thank you, Matin Bhai. Thank you, Manju, for your insightful talk. I think it contributes in its own way to anti-caste politics. And it also holds lessons, I think, for any marginalized sections of society which is grappling with, you know, the politics of dominant representation and, you know, how they feel, you know, the lack in that representation. I'm not going to you know, summarize your talk, you know, because it was very lucid and I think it is clear to all the participants. I will just flag up one or two or three points. First, the talk hinges around the concept which Manju takes from bell hooks, that is oppositional gaze. Okay, so if the upper caste or quote unquote upper caste or upper class, you know, gaze, you know, structures our ways of seeing and looking at the world or our nation in a particular way, which, you know, invisibilizes or erases or stereotypes the quote unquote low castes or other marginalized sections of society. You know, in opposition to that, we have the oppositional gaze, which, you know, brings in, or what Manju says, present the voice, the affects, the experiences of the, you know, quote unquote again, lower castes and the and by extension other marginalized sections of society. So there is this oppositional gaze. And second point, politics of affect, if I may use that term, Manju, because, you know, as you have rightly said, that these movies, you know, by Manjule and, you know, by Ranjit, I have seen Fendry and I have also seen Kala, and I was, you know, fascinating movies those were. And, you know, they present, yeah, the affective domain of, you know, those marginalized sections of society, their experience, their the ontological, you know, experiences. So from the ontology, we go to the third section of your talk. You have, you know, said that there is resistive, you know, epistemology. So from ontology, we go to the sort of resisting epistemology. Okay, so, and that resisting on epistemology, you know, restructures, you know, or invites us to rethink our relationship with the world, or, you know, our relationship with the other sections of society. So in a way that is resistive, that questions the dominant hegemony of the dominant sections of society. And finally, your talk also talks us a kind of engagement, okay? So there is this affective archive and people are invited through cinematic experience to engage with that archive, and, you know, so that there can be a politics of not only antagonism, but also of agonism. So we talk, we understand each other, and maybe we correct ourselves also, if I have understood you correctly. So these are the takeaways from your talk. There are some questions. So I would take those questions, read out those questions to you. And if there is time, maybe, you know, people from base also can join in the discussion. So there is a first question from Sam. He has two interrelated questions. One is, you know, first of all, he wants to know the names of filmmakers or films in Telugu that in recent times changed or challenged popular filmmaking aesthetic. Okay, so names of the filmmakers or films that talks about these in oppositional gaze. And second question is, you know, he wants to know the style or the process of this oppositional gaze or of this, you know, anti-caste aesthetics, you know, as you have talked about with reference to the avant-garde theater practitioner Arthu. So maybe he wants to know more about, you know, how it operates in terms of cinema. So there are these two questions. So I think from, you know, we can go to other questions later on when you answer this question, these questions. Or do you want to take all the questions together?
Maybe I can take two, three questions together.
More, okay, okay. So there is one more question from Sanjida Ejaz, and her question, you know, yeah, that takes up one interesting thing. You know, there was recently a controversy over the film Article 15 by, you know, Abhinav Sinha. So, you know, there was writing that, you know, here in this film, we have a upper caste hero who acts as a kind of savior, you know, so who becomes a kind of savior of the Dalits. So he refers to that, she refers to that, and she wants to know your views, you know, on that. And yeah, there is one question by Sumbul Nasim. I would like to read out the question. Yeah, it goes like this. In a recent short film, Gili Pucci by Neeraj Ghewan, the Dalit character Harti Mandal advises her colleague to have child, which she uses as a cunning to get her colleague's job, because then her colleague gets entangled with child rearing responsibilities and loses her job, and Harti, who was previously denied the job because of her caste, gets the job. So how do you see this vengeful act of Harti Mandal? So these are the questions we have, and after these questions we will go to Shaista Rahman from AMU. Over to you, Manju.
Thank you for that, for some like actually talking, summarizing the thing, my talk, and also, yeah, for the questions, I would just start off from the first question, which was on Telugu films of recent Telugu films, which are largely of anti-caste, which uses anti-caste aesthetic. So one I can think of is Kancherepalem, and the other one is Palasa. So these two films are very different from what we have seen in Telugu cinema for such a long time. So Palasa is very recent. Kancherepalem maybe like 1 or 2 years back, I think. So these two films are two films which has a lot of which are different from the usual Telugu cinemas, or the usual dominant Telugu cinemas, if I could say that. These two films maybe you can look at, and also the style which Sam asked, the style or process, in a sense that so some of the things which I actually mentioned, it is not necessarily a documentary making in all these films. These are most of these films are very cinematic in that sense. They take certain instances or they take certain things and uses the common thing maybe like we can see all these films have is very good music. Like for instance, all Ranjit's films or even Mary Selvaraj's films have music by Santosh Narayan, a new music director who actually brings a lot of folk elements, which are not used in the earlier films or maybe in a more advanced way. This music maybe is one thing, and also cinematography is very important. For instance, in Karnan, we can look at the kind of cinematography has been employed, like looking at certain like minute details. This minute detailing is also something which we can see in their films, and also how they play with images, colors. So it is also providing a certain kind of spectacle, but that spectacle which also is effective in nature. So yeah, through other modes. So these are maybe like some of the styles which I can quickly think of. And yeah, like as I said, they might be similar. For instance, Selvaraj might be similar to Arthaud, but then it's not that he is the same. There is something else which he is doing here. Maybe the in the present context. So that is one thing which I thought I would talk in terms of style, and one more, the other one is on Article 15, which is there are a lot of discussions on the film on Article 15, she has asked my take on the film, right? The film is definitely a very, like, it's a violent film on Dalits, in a sense that it shows only violence. So it's like somebody like Ranjit would say that I don't want to show this kind of violence on screen. Like this is not what he wants to make. He doesn't want to make just films of pain and humiliation or suffering, but he would want to take a film on their celebration or even their struggles. Like, even while they are struggling, there is a life. So this film does not have, or like, there is no life in it. Like, it's largely a gaze on Dalits, a dominant gaze on Dalits. So if you want to know, as in if you want to know more about it, maybe like I think Harish Vankhede has written on it. It's a very good article. So maybe like that would in fact elaborate more on the savior figure and the upper caste savior figure and the Dalits who are to be saved. So maybe like, yeah, I would think it is that it is, I would not call it like, it's not Dalit consciousness. I'm also not for the term Dalit consciousness, which is again an essentializing thing. There's always a becoming, which is you want to break away from all this essentialities which are imposed on you. So in that sense, that's where this anti-caste aesthetics is important. So yeah, and the third one is on, the thing is, I'm really sorry, I haven't seen the film called Geedi Poochi. So I'm just trying to figure out the question which is asked here. I've read about it, but I still haven't seen the film. So. So I don't know whether I would be able to give a comprehensive response to that. Maybe watching the film would give me a better idea to respond to that. I'm sorry, Sambul. Maybe like later, if we have time, we can come back to that.
Yeah, okay, Manju. If I may add to the styles, you know, maybe as Sam has asked, in the movie Kala, you know, the very color, Kala, black, is dissociated from all kinds of negative associations, you know, where we see that the world color represents is black, and the world, if I may use the word antagonist uses, you know, he's surrounded with white. Okay, but you know, but the problem is that white is here representative of all the evils. Okay, so maybe there is, you know, counter to, you know, that kind of dominant, you know, ways of looking through colors, maybe. And one point, so we go to Saista Rahman. He's from Aligarh Muslim University. Over to you, Saista Rahman. Are you there? Hello, Saista Rahman, are you there? Okay, there is one more question. Maybe he is not present here. This question is from Sunil Boshak.
Saistha's question is there already posted in the chat box. His name is called Sanjida Izaz.
Okay. So we move on to the next question. It's by Sunil Boshak. I would like to read out the question. He says that I have not seen those movies. So his question is, you know, related to the introductory note. As you mentioned, the gaze and how the person looking is asserting power. But Butler in Gender Trouble mentions that both the looker and the looked at assert power through gaze. Can you elaborate? You told about the invisibility of Dalit castes, but Mary Wollstonecraft in a Vindication presents the looking glass image where the upper powerful position needs the lowerers to constantly reassess their power. Can you elaborate? Then one more question by Sheikh Abid Hassan. How do you situate cultural capital produced by Kamma and Kapu caste in Telugu cinema? What is your take about the violence on display in Asuran? Do you think Kamal Hassan and Mani Ratnam reproduce Brahmanism in their films? So these are the questions we have at the moment.
I would start off with the question which is on the gaze, which is the looker and the looked at assert power through gaze. So the what I in this context, what I look at is when you watch something when you actually perceive something on from the screen, there is always a look which we give, which is largely like as I said, which is a male gaze, which is constructed by the camera or the industry and all. So from a shift from there in this one is, so to start off, I start told about there is always a look that is to be looked at and also the to look at. So two things to talk about it. This is the kind of power positions which is at work, which I mentioned. So to take from maybe like Butler's Gender Trouble. So here in the sense, the venue, the spectator becomes powerful or what we can call as so if we look at a particular scene, for instance, I can just take even Malvi's example of the objectified woman. So you always look at her largely from a dominant, like that's a gaze which is produced by the camera or the cinema, where even if you are a woman who is objectified, even if you look at, you might be looking through the male gaze, because that's the way it is constructed. So it is from that level, it works in a sense that though it might be that there will be power locations, the power positions might be different, but the way screen or the way a camera constructs or the way a film constructs certain images would be from only through a particular perspective. In this case, it is male gaze. So it is at that level, it is at work. That's what I can say in this context. And the second one is, presents the looking glass image where the upper powerful position needs the low, like a lower position. It's about like, in order to reassert power, it's like the self, the debates on self. So we always tell that the self is defined in terms of like other. So you are you because like in terms of like, because you're not the other one, or it is in that sense that we can also take that thing here in a sense that you have to in order to reassert from one's dominant position, you would want or you would anyway need a need somebody to look down upon. So that is clear, like in this like as you said, that is clear. So in cinema, how does it work is so most of these films are like, not the films which I mentioned, but most of the popular films which we see are made by this people from dominant class, caste and background. And in for instance, in Hindi cinema, you sometimes don't even like, it's, there is a normalization of caste, that is, you have that like, not necessarily just Hindi cinema, also like other industries, like how you want to like for instance, if a topic of marriage comes, you want to know the caste of somebody's like the girls or the guys' background or like family or even like for instance surnames. So you cannot get rid of the caste. So it is at that level, it is not necessarily like always shown as something is powerful or something is down. It is sometimes very like normalized. Caste is not presented as an atrocity or a violence, but it is always shown as something which is very normalized in our cinema. So it is at, in that level, what these people are doing is would be to actually project it as violence or as atrocity. So so I don't know whether I answered these questions correctly. So I would actually look at here something else also he had asked, I think, which is about the real. So is it a Plato's ideal world or Foucault's heterotopia which you are mentioning? So see, the in a sense here, the real in a sense which I look at is there is the post-structural readings, which would be of course was also like one of the major figures. But then in post-structural readings, there is always there is no real, right? It's all constructed. So that is the it is like, you, what you see on the screen is constructed, or what you read on the book is all, everything is constructed. There is no real, or there is always that is at play. But see, in the case of for instance Dalits, these things will not work always. There is a reality that people are getting killed on an everyday basis, so we can't always tell that there is a real which is being constructed, or it is through that, or like there is signified and signifier and they create this and all. But it is at that level I was actually looking at these things in a sense we talk on a regular basis. So what is, there is a reality that people are getting killed, and also how we take that and actually use certain kind of aesthetics to look at or to go beyond that real. We don't, like Ranjit says, I don't want to make films on pain or suffering. Like, I want to make films on their life, their, of course, their struggles, but their a colorful life world. So that is the real which I actually like mentioned in the talk. And Kamma Kapu, Telugu cinema is largely like very caste based industry, like so in that so it is definitely like you don't see many other communities entering there. So it is very caste based industry. So that's why it is very interesting to see this kind of films emerging in Telugu cinema. So I don't see such kind of films in so called progressive Malayalam cinema, which is considered as very progressive. So such films are actually not happening much in Malayalam cinema, but in which actually follows realist aesthetics, which kind of at least which prefers realist aesthetics. So when you go beyond, like behind just the real, you actually miss out a lot of other things. You actually miss out this anti-caste history or the assertion. So in Telugu, I've noticed only these two films. I don't know, maybe like people who are familiar with the industry can perhaps tell more. But yeah, it is a very caste-based industry, like in Telugu. I mean, you can see this families, generations who are producers, who are directors, who are actors. It's just continuation of that. There is no change. Like there is no there's like you don't see many people entering. It's very closed industry in that sense, but there are changes like these days which are like noticeable. And also, yeah, violence on a display in Asuran. So there is a comparison between Asuran and Karnan which is being going on, which is because both in a sense that Dhanush films, and which actually like based in certain villages and then upper caste violence on them, there is the big difference would be like in Karnan, this Karnan comes back as somebody who does something for the community, and then though his life is gone, he comes as victorious, and he sees like his people are being able to go to school or to colleges. There is a bus stop at his place, though he was in jail for 10 years, and he comes back to a completely changed place. Whereas Asuran's it's a different Asuran's, the violence which we can see in the film is also like a continuation of what's happening in Tamil cinema from the 2000s. So there are a lot of films which showed caste violence on screen. So which is actually not same as what somebody like Mari Selvaraj is doing. So yeah, there is only like one side, though there are also changes, but then it is not as same as what Mari Selvaraj is doing. So Asuran would be different from Karnan in that sense. So and Kamal Haasan and Maniratnam reproduce Brahminism in their films. I can actually suggest you can read Rajesh Rajamani has an article on Kala and Nayakan, which is where he talks about how Kala's Rajnikanth and like Ranjit's film, which came in 2018, and Nayagan is I think 20 years back or something it came. I don't remember the year, which is directed by Maniratnam, acted by Kamal Haasan. So there is an inversion of the images of Nayagan in Kala. To add on to what Murshid just told, the color, why the antagonist or that Hari Dada, who's the villain, is in white. It's also like in Nayagan, everybody wears white. Even the people who are behind Kamal Haasan, like who just come and go, they all like, it's curiously white. That's what Rajamani calls. So there is a kind of an inversion of these images through these kind of filmmakers. So yeah, so I think like maybe that article actually opens up a lot of other viewpoints, like how he uses black aesthetically, or like why there is an inversion of this white and all this, which you can look at. Yeah.
Any other question? If you have any question, so you may ask it directly to Manju. If you have any question, I would request the participants here. If you have any question, you can go directly to Manju. Sumit Mahaskar. Hello, Sumit. So your question to Manju.
Hi, Sumit.
Hi, Manju. Thanks for the presentation. I think it's always great to hear from what you have been doing. As a non-cinema, researcher, what I would like to know is, obviously, there is this one strand of films, they reproduce caste stereotypes. Okay, so there is a caste gaze that is being reproduced. Okay, that's on one hand. On the other hand, we have now a new genre of films. They are trying to subvert these kind of gazes. Okay, so these are definitely two kind of cinemas that we have. But then there is also a third kind of cinema which I feel somewhere where they make a big attempt of subversion and yet they reproduce the same gaze. So in your analysis of these films, where they are not explicitly made through anti-caste lens, but these are, let's say, called the progressive lenses in a way, where the attempt is to be very kind in terms of looking at the subjects and not to see them through that particular lens. Now, in the films that you have, you know, say, reviewed today, or you have analyzed them, is that particular aspect visible very clearly in those films, or is it absolutely a different kind of film and it is only then we can see it? So if you can comment on this little bit of mixture, because we have this tendency to look at one kind of film which is stereotypically looking at in a very casteist manner, and then the other one which is constantly subverting. But I think there is this very gray area where the attempt is to look at the subjects in a way that actually it's very, you know, it is subverting, but it is actually reinforcing those things. So can you say a little bit about that?
Okay, thanks Sumit for the question. So I'll just maybe like with examples I'll talk about this. So the three categories which you told, like one is a reproduction of caste stereotypes, second one is the subversions or the kind of subversions to that, and the third one is which are apparently subversions but kind of reproduce the stereotypes or kind of progressive, what you called. So in my analysis, so what I found is most of the films which we largely see are have actually caste stereotypes, which are the dominant films which would have somebody who would come to work at home would be like, for instance, if you we take the film for instance the Thappad. So it's only the progressive thing. It only happens to the upper caste woman or the upper class woman. So it is, there is always like you only see that, whereas there is always a caste stereotype, not necessarily like caste stereotype. It is a stereotyping in many other ways, even the community, religion, or all this. Like there is one kind of films which are that maybe like I haven't told certain films in my presentation, but largely we can see a lot of films like that. But what I see in this film, in this presentations are, these are subversions. At the same time, it is offering something new. That's what I was pushing at. Not necessarily the third category. Third category would be something like Article 15, which would be it is an attempt to create something which is which shows caste atrocity. The same way, we can also see in films like Malapilla or Neelakuyil or Sujata or so many, even Hindi films, like earlier Hindi films, even Lagan, all these films have, these are maybe like the third kind which you are talking about. What I am looking at is like it does not stop with just mere subversion. There is something else which these directors are doing, that is to through so many other senses to break the sense of the caste as a caste sensorium, as a regime of it's a sensorial regime of caste. So how do you break that through a kind of certain kind of an affective filmmaking? So that is what I am trying to look at.
Thank you.
Thanks so much for the question.
Do you have any more question? We can take one more question.
I think Chandu has raised his hand.
Okay. Yeah. Please.
Thank you, Manju. That is an excellent presentation. thanks to Sumit also for bringing that question. What I'm thinking, like in a similar terms, what Sumit asked, particularly this third category, it started. I think I'm audible.
Yeah, thank you.
It started in Telugu film industry now. As you mentioned, except Palasa and Kancharla Palam, particularly Palasa is very much a film like Karnan. Whereas there are other films have come recently with, I mean, this is a bit moving ahead of crossing boundaries of Telugu film industry, keeping Dalit as a protagonist, as a hero. There are two films recently have come. One is Color Photo and other one is last week it was released, Arthashatabdam, like 50th, 50 century, half century. So both movies keep hero from Dalit community, but you know, they don't move beyond the existing structure, caste structure, where hero from Dalit community obviously is killed, unlike Selvarajan's Perumal, that movie, where hero is very much assertive and you know, rebel, progressive, these kinds of things. So there is a, I mean, in a way, Tamil film industry have set up a model for at least Telugu film industry, and people are looking up now. You know, I could see directors and producers, actors from other, from marginalized communities, you know, to be seen in the film industry, and that's the great attempt change that happened in Telugu film industry. Yeah, that's all. Thank you, Manju, for this wonderful presentation.
Thanks, Chandu. So Chandu also works on Telugu cinema. So yeah, so I haven't seen the films Color Photo and Arthashatabdam, but yeah, there is, I actually felt there is a kind of an influence of this what is happening in Tamil cinema across the at least in the south, even a lot of films in Malayalam, because of these things which are happening in Tamil industry, you are actually forced to refer to it, or you are actually like, in a sense that it becomes necessary that you make a statement, or you have to create a cinema which has a different sensibility, not necessarily only the upper caste sensibility which we have seen. Such a thing has been, I think it is happening in like, perhaps at least I can say that it is happening at least in Malayalam and Telugu. So though I don't, since I haven't seen this film, I am not so sure. But then yeah, even a film like when, I don't know, maybe like if you have more, you can say like a film like Rangasthalam, which is a popular film, which I think, which is also like, in a sense that I don't know, there are things which they want to actually take in, or to even the music or the story, or so many things are also like, you can actually find similarities, but it tells like a different story or a progressive or whatever story. But then yeah, there are influences of the kind of movement which is happening in Tamil industry, in all the other at least in other South Indian industries like Malayalam and Telugu. I'm not so sure about Kannada. But yeah, even in like now, these, because of these articulations, like even in Hindi, it has now, I think there are attempts, even for instance, like somebody has just referred Gili Poochi, since I haven't seen the film, like I am not in a position to talk much about it. But then there are like, for instance, Article 15 just came, and or there are films which it kind of becomes a necessity to talk about these issues, since there is a movement or larger discourse about it. It's not that these films are there like in Tamil, because of social media, technology, people are actually talking about it. So it's a larger larger crowd or a larger platform we have now to talk about such things. So yeah, that is also one way of looking at it.
So I don't think we have any more questions. So thank you, Manju. And thank you to those who asked the questions. Yeah. Now we move on to the final section, formal vote of thanks. And it will be given by Ismail Sarkar. Over to you, Ismail Sarkar.
Thank you, sir. Assalamu alaikum and a very good evening to all of you present here. Sir, I'm audible? Sir?
You are.
Yes, you are, yeah.
First, I must thank BASE for giving me this wonderful opportunity to deliver a vote of thanks today on behalf of BASE, Bengali Academia for Social Empowerment. I'd like to extend my heartfelt thanks to Dr. Manju Idachira ma'am for her very insightful and interesting speech on towards an anti-caste aesthetics deconstructing gaze in Indian cinema. She talked about how cinema has treated Dalit in India, like Tamil film, Hindi film, Malayalam film. She also talked about aesthetic experience, aspirations, deconstruction of the popular, and so many very much informative speeches she has delivered today. Thank you so much, ma'am, for your encouraging and deliberations. Now I must thank our own Abdul Martin sir, who chaired today's session so well. He is our own BASE member and he's an assistant professor of Jadavpur University. He always guides us in each and every aspect. Thank you, sir. I also thank Mr. Murshid Alam sir, assistant professor of Gobango University, for his wonderful conducting the question answer sessions. Thank you, sir. I must thank BASE president, vice president, and GS, and all the members, especially those who are really working hard on organizing this kind of lecture series on a regular basis and contributing to social responsibilities, disseminating knowledge and information. Last but not the least, I cordially thank to all the delegates of this program who showed constant interest in our lecture series and whose participation is a matter of great encouragement and motivation for us. Thank you all once again, and please do not forget to join us in our next BASE lecture series. Soon we will announce the topic and the speaker. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum.
Okay, can I tell something?
Yeah.